Okay, so I have the answer, but facing the world with this answer is like getting cold water splashed on your face. So you have to get used to that, and it's a matter of going back to it again and again and again and again and again, which I've been doing. So let's go over it again. The real problem, trace the problem back to its very root, is that when we whimsically decided to be arrogant and believe we could change God's will, okay, meaning there's some will separate from God's will, because it's not God's will to change God's will. So to believe we can change God's will means there's a separate will separate to God, which is arrogance. There's no will separate from God. When we decided to do that, we found that it was impossible. We can't change God's will. This is the feeling. It's impossible. And I don't like to try to do the impossible. So we this feeling was, I don't like it. I don't want to do this. Now, what arrogance did was it immediately misinterpreted it as meaning we feel guilty about doing this. And then immediately it said, I have a plan for getting rid of that guilt, and that is called death. Okay, immediately. And so it's boom, boom, like that, just boom, boom. No, this is guilt, I have a plan, death, and we have been enmeshed in this plan ever since. And we're so used to this plan, we think it has to work. And so we're absolutely dead set against getting free of death. Okay, now, so we think that everyone has to die, and this is the only way. We can't have anyone have eternal life. Everyone has to keep dying and dying, and that's the only way to get rid of guilt. And so really the only way that arrogance can hold this idea of changing God's will, having a separate will in place, is this, have this massive sacrificial scenario continuously going on, so it can point that our problem is we feel guilty about overcoming God, but we can overcome this guilt, and yet we can't. It's not guilt, so it really doesn't overcome guilt at all. And so arrogance just has to keep it going. There's no end point to it. There's no end point to it. You must realize there's no end game to the sacrificial plan of arrogance. It just continues on until you finally are enlightened and finally realize, wait a minute, this was never needed in the first place. The only way to get free of it is to realize it was never needed in the first place whatsoever. It's not needed now. It won't be needed at some other point. It's never been needed and never will. It's a total mistake. The problem is not guilt. The problem is impossibility. And since it's impossible, we have nothing to do but to set our arrogance down, so we can't change the will of God. But the only way to entertain this whim is this massive plan of sacrifice, a sacrificial universe that just continues on and on and on and on with no resolution to it whatsoever. Because it's not solving guilt, because guilt really doesn't exist. Guilt towards God doesn't exist. We didn't do anything to God. We can't change God's will, so there is no guilt. So it's like a remedy in search of a problem. And there'll never be the problem of guilt. So it's just continually futile. It doesn't do anything. And we keep thinking, no, that someone is escaping death. We need to pull everybody into it. And that's why we keep pulling those in the afterlife back into this. The universe keeps pulling them back into this. The goddess keeps saying, hey, got to dance the dance of death. It's essential. Otherwise, we'll be annihilated. In other words, our will be destroyed. Well, we don't have a separate will. So how can you destroy nothing? It's an absurdity. So this clarity is lost on this universe. There's very few that can even relate to this at all right now. So they insist that you simply go along with their plan and say, well, I can't relate to that, I understand. Well, it doesn't matter if they can relate to it or not, it's still a fact. doesn't change the fact at all. And they will have to relate to it at some point, so might as well get started. There isn't any way around it at all. And what happens is they get even more furious and say, no, we demand the death of everyone. And so it's intimidating because you think, well, if I get free, you know, they'll get so angry that they'll demand my death and they'll be so strong I won't be able to deal with it. So I have to try to get on the good side of them somehow. But this never works. This never works. Really, enlightenment has to be very clear. You have to get very clear about it. And if you, and we choose the death-free realm. I mean, I was very clear this morning about the whole situation, and I realized that, yeah, I am very likely an apostle of Jesus, and I put the very there because this world cannot stand certainty. The mindset of this world cannot stand certainty. What is certain? God is certain. God's will is certain. There is only will, one will, and that's God's will. There is no other will whatsoever. There's no will but God's. This is absolute certainty. So the attempt to change this will, of course, hates certainty. Okay, it rules it out entirely. So when you're trying to speak to people here in this world, spirits who think they're in this world, who engage in a sacrificial attempt to atone for an imaginary guilt, you can't be certain with them. You cannot speak in certitudes. This causes extreme upset in them, and they feel they're being attacked. So you really cannot relate to them at all through certitude. So that's why I say very likely. And at least there's some wiggle room. They say, okay, well, he's not certain. Good. Well, you know, I'm certain, but I can't say that I'm certain. So let's put it that way. So I say it's very likely I'm an apostle of Jesus, because an apostle of Jesus is able to look and see this situation of imaginary guilt in the sacrificial universe trying to atone for imaginary guilt, which is a misinterpretation of impossibility. Okay, it's an arrogant misinterpretation of impossibility. This is what an apostle of Jesus has to be able to do. And then from this, seeing this, then I'm able to see, you know, the big context of the world. For example, there are different different phases, third dimension, fourth dimension, fifth dimension, and these are all being mixed together right now. There's a separating out, actually. It's separating out between third, fourth, and fifth dimensions. And third dimension is the best teaching right now in the world is Islam for third dimensionals. Okay, that's, and the best teaching for fourth dimensionals is goddess worship, and the best teaching for fifth dimensionals is Jesus Christ, A Course in Miracles. But ultimately, the teaching of Jesus Christ and the apostles of Jesus Christ is this apostolic plan of Jesus. That is for fifth dimensionals, okay? And so that's why when the fifth dimensionals are getting ready probably to leave this place, okay? This is what's called the rapture. And they're getting ready to go to a death-free realm. The third dimensionals are getting ready to probably go to another third dimensional planet, and the fourth dimensionals are getting ready to, they hope, inherit this world. They want this world to be their center. And so in this vacuum, as Christians are getting ready to leave, those who really are willing to go along with the apostolic plan of Jesus, they're getting ready to leave. And into this vacuum, the Islam is pouring into this vacuum, trying to take over the world, and they're battling with the fourth dimensionals for control of this world, which is what's really happening. So I see this very clearly. So I say it's very likely I'm an apostle of Jesus. Very, very likely. But I won't say for certain here, because that make people feel they're attacked. Almost everyone here will feel they're very badly attacked if you go at them with certitude here, which makes it, you know, difficult. It's frustrating. It's a frustration that I have to, you know, you think, gee, if you could just give certitude, they would believe you. But no, instead they feel they're attacked. They're being attacked. So It's very likely, let's say there's a rapture will take place. It's very likely that it's a death-free realm. It's very likely. But you cannot say with certitude. And people say, well, you're not certain. So, well, apostles of Jesus don't have to be certain. It's not required that you be absolutely certain. Just very, very likely certain. All right? We'll leave the certitude to Jesus for now, from a pragmatic standpoint. Now, the fourth dimensionals, what are they about? They believe that the problem with arrogance is right governance. That the sacrificial scenario, the reason why it's not working is because it doesn't have the right governance. So fourth dimensionals are very, very focused on governance, right governance. Fair systems of governance, right systems of governance. This is what they're very interested in. Now, the third dimensionals, they believe that this plan of guilt, expiation of guilt, which is death, this dream of death is what it is not working because the flesh is resisting it, or the it needs to be. We need to accept it. Okay, then the flesh is getting in the way. We have some sort of rebellion, lack of acceptance of it. And so they try to discipline, they use moral discipline as the key to accepting your death. Accepting death, being submission to death is what that plan is, submission to death. And we see this right now with radical Islam, just killing everybody they get their hands on. I mean, submit to death. So this third dimensional teachings generally tell us that we need to submit to death, and we're rebellious towards that, and we need to discipline ourselves so we can submit to death. That's basic third dimensional teachings. And that's what they insist that Jesus do. Third dimensional says, no, you need to submit to death, Jesus. And then, of course, the resurrection showed, oh, he didn't succeed in killing me in the first place. You can't kill spirit. That plan is a failure. So third dimensional religions are a failure. Fourth dimensional religions say you just have to organize it properly. That's all. Proper organization. So you get these fourth dimensionals coming this world with all their technology, which is designed to organize this dream of death better, organize it better. Let's have efficient death. Let's have compassionate death. Let's have assisted suicide death. Let's have healthy lives before we die. Let's organize our lives so at least we lived a really nice, happy life until we died. Let's make sure everything's fair. So it's trying to organize the dream of death. So, okay, whereas fifth dimensional teaching, which is what Jesus brought to this world, actually. Is to say there is no death. Death is just a make-believe dream, and we don't need it at all. We've never needed it, which is why you end up in a death-free realm. Okay, you end up in a death. And I, as I said before, I was taken to a death-free realm. I was taken there and shown it, and I was like, well, talk about a wow. You see, this is where I got clued into to full stop in the wow, how important it is, because when I was in a death-free realm. I said, wow. I said, gosh, where am I? And I kind of looking around and said, wow, this is a nice place. It's a really nice place. I like it. I love it. I love this place. Where is this place? I love it. And then I started looking more closely and I said, hey, wait a minute. There's something different about this place. What is it? And it slowly began dawning upon me. Nothing's ever died here. There's never been any decay here. There's no decay. There's no fallen leaves. There's nothing decaying. There's nothing dying. There's nothing aging. There was a sort of a faint echo of aging in terms of things growing, but in terms of getting older, no. Everything was like in the absolute fresh bloom of perfectness, and there was no sign of aging whatsoever, and nothing had ever died. I realized that. And I said, wow. This is great, and then what happened was, the shock of being there, this wow started building up on me, and super intense wow. And I couldn't maintain my attention there. It was too much. The wow was too much for me. I said, "Oh my gosh, what is this? What is this? What is this?" I started getting panicky, and then poof, my spiritual attention shifted off of it back to this world. So at that point, I knew, wow, I've got a problem. I have this continuity problem. I can get there, but I can't stay there. So what good is that? I gotta be able to stay there. So Jesus' teachings, especially A Course in Miracles, and he basically seeded the beginnings of that right spiritual practice that would get us to the fifth dimension, knowing that there would be this time here where we were ready, and where the fourth dimensionals would come in and try to take over this planet, and then there'd be this terrible conflict with Islam and also some third dimensional Christians. So the third dimensionals and the fourth dimensionals are headed for a big dust up. And at that time, the fifth dimensionals will exit the place, most likely, to the death-free realm. Now, going to the death-free realm is the problem of the wow. So I've been introducing this teaching, a full stop in the wow, where it's possible that when you go to a death-free realm, you might have to just stay in a small area first and have teachers there helping you, and just engage in spiritual practice, that's all. You say, yeah, I want to stay here, but I've got this problem. They say, well, it's okay. There's a way to evaporate this problem, you see. And so that's why there'll be teachers there who'll be able to help. And you might not be able to just wander about freely in this death-free realm for quite some time, actually, until you work through this continuity issue. You might gradually take little guided trips here and there, and then go back to your little tribal, enclave. You'll probably be like little tribal enclaves and not much communication between them, because the wow is too intense. If you realize that this death-free realm extends everywhere, then the wow gets too intense, you see. So you can say, hey, wait a minute, this place where I'm at right now is just like awesomely great, but I'm not sure if that's everywhere. Maybe it's maybe it's likely it's everywhere, but I'm not really sure, and I really can't, I'm not ready to find out the truth of the situation yet. So this is a way of looking at it. I feel I'd be able to help there in the death-free realm from all the work I've done here. That would not be a stretch. And there may be Jesus and the apostles may go from encampment to encampment and just, sit down and give teaching and say, this is the practice I'd like you to practice, and explain. And then you would start practicing, and your days will be, your time will be centered around spiritual practice. So there'll be just little ashrams everywhere, little spiritual retreats everywhere, basically. And little churches, if you want to call them, little temples, little spiritual sanctuaries, where you spend your time. This is what your life is centered around, right? Spiritual practice. And then gradually the wow will get less and less and less, and you'll be able to ultimately accept that, yeah, this is what I deserve. This is the intermediate step. This is part of the glorification of perfection, part of the glorification of perfection, which is the intermediate step back to reality. Back to, out of dreaming, dropping the dream altogether. We've been trying to aggrandize arrogance, glorify, but really aggrandize arrogance. And now we turn this effort now towards actually glorifying perfection. And our spiritual practice is part of that effort. The Holy Spirit gives us the basic context, death-free realm, but then our spiritual practice is our role that we need to play in that. Now, the third dimensionals will eventually realize that submission to death isn't the answer. The fourth dimensionals realize that governance isn't the right answer to this dream of death. So eventually they'll get interested in true fifth dimensional teaching, true liberation theology, the true liberation theology. Yeah. So this is just a broad outline. We don't want to try to explain everything. It'll overwhelm. It's overwhelming. So, you know, I only know what is important to know in terms of broad terms. I could know more, but that gets in the way because one of the problems here is overloading people with information too much. They say, oh, wow. No, just give me the, can you just give me the simple basics? That's better. Yeah. So here we are in America, it's July 4th, Independence Day, so it's a great day to talk about this. Now the third and fourth dimensionals, they can't stand any appearances of like Jesus because they'd say, no, you're dead. What do you mean you can't appear? If you want to appear, you have to appear as a body. You cannot appear as a light body. The light body can't be killed. We insist that anything appears here has to be subject to death. This is their insistence. That everything that appears here has to be subject to death. You cannot have any appearance here that isn't subject to death. So an apparition, a light body appearance of Jesus would throw them, they would just be furious at that. It says, I can't accept this. It's totally unacceptable to them. And I always wondered, what the heck's the matter with them? So they don't allow you to see entities who are not, don't have a body. They say, no, you can only see bodies. That's it. Because only bodies are subject to death. But actually, even subtle bodies are subject to death too. But there are light bodies that are not subject to it, actually. But here, we want to be, you know, really feel the super intense subjection to death, okay, as a way to try to expiate or atone for our guilt. See, this is what arrogance tells us. Arrogance tells us, yeah, you killed God. Your problem is you feel extremely guilty about it. So, by paying the price through dying yourself, experiencing the same death that you gave to God, then that's how you can get rid of this guilt. So the third dimensionals think they killed Jesus, and then they say, yeah, okay, now, but we want to martyr ourselves too, so that we also experience the same death that you did, and then that will get rid of our guilt about killing God, you see? So yeah, we killed God, and we feel so guilty, but we can get rid of that guilt by our own martyrdom. This is a third dimensional, heavy, delusion, okay. Fourth dimensionals just say, Jesus, you're dead. You gotta stay dead. Nobody returns from the grave. Your dead is dead. And we just want to make sure we have right schooling, right teaching, right learning, right governance, right regulations. It's all about, you know, getting it right to the last detail of, you know, right use of day, how to use your time, right friends, right everything. Governance, organization, rules, regulations, bureaucracy. This is what the fourth dimensionals are into. And that's, they're bringing this to this planet, trying to control everything here. And of course, the third dimensionals don't like that at all. They say, no, all we have to do is submit to death, and that will be sufficient. Arrogance will accept that. We just have to have perfect submission to death. So Jesus said, you want perfect submission to death? You think that's the answer? Okay, we'll see if that's the answer. Go ahead. I'll do that for you. I'll prove to you it's not the answer. So Jesus submitted to torture and crucifixion perfectly. There's never been a more perfect submission to death than what he did. And what happened? Bing! Resurrection. Guess what, folks? I'm back. Doesn't work. You can't kill God. Yeah, and they didn't like that part. So, the Jews, they rejected that. Islam has rejected that. Islam rejects the resurrection of Jesus, as far as I know, right? Reject a lot of it. He's just a good prophet, submitted to death, nice submission to death. And sometimes, anyway, they reject, it's rejected. The Jews reject it. Islam has rejected it. Buddhism doesn't pay much attention to it. Fourth dimensional certainly reject it. Because it's fifth dimensional. It's truly liberating. I don't even know if the Buddhists take any position on Jesus at all, actually. Or the Hindus give any position at all, which is okay. Those are two that might pile more information on the plate than we, can handle. But right now, the big players in this game are the fourth dimensionals and Islam, absolutely. Absolutely. And the Christians, okay? Now, some Christians have a lot of trouble with this. They struggle with it, which is to be expected. It's extremely tough teaching that, hey, you can't kill God. We say, what do you mean? This entire universe is based on the belief we killed God. This whole universe, the whole purpose of it, is to expiate, atone for the guilt of killing God. What do you mean we can't kill God? This is very difficult, isn't it? That means they say, well, I have to change my whole belief system. That means I don't even need the universe. Well, what the heck? If I don't need the universe, what the heck am I going to do? I have to set it down and disappear. Why? It scares the heck out of me. Yes, the fifth dimensional teaching says there's an intermediate step, which is the death-free realms, which you can even experience here, even when you're in this world. Actually, you can experience a different universe, a blessed universe, a glorified universe, a universe that reflects which is the notion of glorifying perfection, which is, of course, symbolic, perceptual, which is all symbolic. It's still a dream, but you can experience the glory of perfection, the glorification of perfection, even while you're here. But also, there is a death-free realm. So I'm not exactly sure how those two situations will play out going forward, but we are told, Jesus told us, that there will be an end times, and we're most certainly in the end times now. As a likely apostle of Jesus, a very likely apostle of Jesus, I can say it's very likely we're in the end times, and it's very likely that the severe tribulation will come upon this planet. Very, very likely. Ultimately, I was shown this planet's bound for a fourth dimensional planet. Of obsession with regulation and governance and all this stuff, but it will go through a remodeling phase. Now, I don't know if that remodeling is actually topographical, or is it ideological? See, I'm not exactly sure. I was shown the whole world being melted down like as smooth as a cue ball, but that could have meant that what happens is extreme unification of belief on the planet. That could also mean that, which means fourth dimensionals insist that everybody, hive mindness, everybody has a uniform thinking, hive mindness. So it could have been a spiritual melting down. Okay. And before that happened, there was this intense pouring rain that happened that melted everything down equally. Now, so it could mean a rain of a spiritual rain of intimidation, of extreme beating everything down into everybody thinking the same way and agreeing to all the same beliefs. It could have meant that also, So whether, Jesus had told us that the world be destroyed by fire, won't be destroyed by water, it'll be destroyed by fire. I don't know, maybe Jesus, the Old Testament told us that, but maybe this the fire of fourth dimensional bullying, or fourth dimensional execution, which they're very good at too. The Nazis were a trial run for fourth dimensionality. See, they wanted to create a one world order where they ruled and everybody had the same rules, get rid of, one language, one set of rules, one banking, one money, one banking. Everything is just one system. One, and that's what Germany, the Nazis wanted to do. One world system. They would be the administrators and bureaucrats of it. That's fourth dimensional. And of course, their plan where the Jews trying their belief is that through continual sacrifice we can make guilt successful. You know, so they believe in the sacrificial belief. Similar to Islam, right? It's a mission to death, but sacrifice, they were more into sacrifice. And so the fourth dimensionals hated that. They said, no, that's not needed. We can just give, if we get the right system, world system, that will work. So there was a clash there between the fourth dimensionals and the Jews, who were largely third dimensional. You might even say they're sort of in between third and fourth dimensional, actually. They're sort of like this idea of playing off the third and fourth dimension against them, each other, and then benefiting from that. They think that's the way. So yeah, the Germans, the Nazis, really were very upset about that. And so they're very, very efficient executors. Efficient. They're very efficient at rounding up the dissidents and in executing them. Fourth dimensionals. And of course they say, well, the ends justify the means. They're getting in the way of right governance. How dare they? You know, that's completely unacceptable. You can't have guns. Nobody can have, they say, only the government can have guns. Right? Because the government has the right to make sure everybody complies with the bureaucratic orders, and nobody can resist. If you resist, off with your head. It's that simple. They say, hey, you know, we have to weed out the undesirables. They're very tolerant as long as everybody goes along with exactly what they say. And if they don't, they say, well, this is simply someone who's opting out. So let's help them opt out. So these fourth dimensionals have set up camps. You know, they do have a plan to carry out this elimination of dissidents. They've been working at that for a long time. And this is what a lot of people, conspiracy people, are talking about. You know, this is, hey, you know, just look at all what they're doing. You know, yeah, yeah. That's their expertise. They're very good at that. They're just like the Germans are very, very good at it, right? And ahead of time, they built all these concentration camps. They staffed them. You know, they planned ahead of time. You know, and they're very thorough, very good at forward planning. Fourth dimensionals are very good at bureaucratic forward planning, governance and forward planning. So of course they have been engaged in this forward planning here, because the fourth dimensionals touched down in Germany, because they felt that Germany was the one that was most ready for that. Okay, and they got spiritual guidance. A lot of this comes from extraterrestrials, actually, fourth dimensional extraterrestrials, who are very good at telepathy, and they telepathically impress upon people what their plans are and what they should do. And the Germans were guided by extraterrestrials, fourth dimensional extraterrestrials, as how to go about what they were doing. And so after World War II, you know, Operation Paperclip, many Germans, and of course the German educational system have been in place to develop a fourth dimensional world here for a long time. It's been in place since Prussian King, quite some time ago. So what happened was, the fourth dimensionals then came over to the United States, and this was their headquarters now. They began to fourth dimensional spirit guidance, or telepathic guidance, to many in the United States, in corporations in the United States, hierarchy and intellectuals, etc., and again, you know, guiding them of how to go about this eventual complete global takeover. And so they have been planning for, since World War II, ultimately the final crushing of all dissent on this planet, especially in America, because Americans have guns, and that's a big problem for them. So they generate crises. They intentionally generate crises. You notice most of the people who take part in these crises, the perpetrators are mentally deranged, and they're hearing voices, they're being guided. They're being guided intentionally to do what they're doing by fourth dimensional extraterrestrials. And that is to create, you know, some slaughter, massacre somewhere. And then, of course, the leaders of America will stand up and scream, you know, got to take everybody's guns. This is terrible. We've had enough. So they, you know, the fourth dimensionals generate these crises, and then they tell the demagogues to insist that everyone has to give up their guns. This is, they're very intent upon this, and they keep working on it, keep working on it, because they don't want any rowdy third dimensionals here on this planet resisting their efforts to put them in, you know, put them in helicopters and whisk them off to the execution camps. So this is what's going on in this world. This is, we've, you know, World War II happened, the Nazis happened. We need to look and realize, wow. And of course, Communist China has happened too. That was another trial run. Soviet Union trial run. I mean, you talk about rounding up dissidents. You know, basically, Soviet Union tried to starve Ukraine, tried to starve them all to death, is what they really tried to do. They said, hey, we can't control them. They put all the grain in silos, in storage sheds, okay? All the harvest, all the food they put in storage sheds, and then they put military guarding the storage sheds and wouldn't allow any food to go out to the people of the Ukraine and literally try to starve everybody in the Ukraine to death. Historic fact. And of course they lied about it, saying, no, we just had distribution problems. No, they didn't. Yeah, the distribution problem is they wouldn't allow any. That was the distribution problem. So the fourth dimensionals are really a piece of work, you know. They really are. So are the third dimensionals too. As we know, the radical Islam, the radicals are a piece of work, aren't they? I mean, really, it's just like submit to our, you know, our teachings, which are really submission to death, or we'll just kill you right now. We can kill you. You can die later, and be right about it, or you can die right now and be and we're saving you from being wrong about it. You know, it's just immediate execution, off with their heads. So, yeah, they're a piece of work too, for sure. And so these are not nice folks, actually. These are very frightened folks. They say, we got to make guilt work. If we don't make guilt work, you know, we're going to be faced with impossibility, which is our annihilation, you know, spiritual annihilation. This is what arrogance tells them. Arrogance says, hey, if you're not arrogant, you're nothing. Your choice is either arrogance or nothingness. But guess what? Arrogance is nothingness. So the real choice is between nothing and everything. That's the real choice that Jesus told us. So, you know, don't mock Jesus too much or have scorn with Jesus too much, because you're really mocking your salvation. And your options aren't too sweet, are they? Now, of course, if you play along with those options, you know, then you think, well, everything's going great for me, except these things don't work. And eventually you start rebelling from them, and then it gets very nasty. Look at Islam. I mean, most of the killing is Islam on Islam, you know, the Shiites and Sunnis killing one another, and even, you know, killing within the groups, Sunnis killing Sunnis. And Shiites killing Shiites, and because you're not submitting properly, you know, it's not working because you're not submitting properly. You know, this death doesn't atone for guilt because you're not submitting properly. And the fourth dimension, it's you know, compliance with rules and regulations isn't working because you're breaking them. You're not zealous enough about complying. You know, you're something. You know, we got to do some more genetic tinkering on you and stuff. And you say, no, I don't like that. I'm tired of it. What? You're tired of what works? How? That's terrible. We need to put you through severe re-education. And then, re-education is terrible. So, this is the madness that is the dream. It is the madness. We're just bringing it to light and showing you, you know, it's just a wow. Now, fifth dimension, death-free realm, has this continuity problem. That's the only problem it has. Which is why I've been working for years now on this continuity issue, bringing it to light and practice. Those who want to go there need to at least realize, take refuge in practice, okay? So, they have to realize that practice is possible. This is what I'm saying. You must realize that practice is at least possible, right practice. And I've brought up a lot of these right practices. Agree with your adversary. Jesus really brought the right practice to the world in relation to the fifth dimensional death-free realm. So you start getting clued in to the right practice. And that's what we've done here. I've brought many practices forth in the videos to clue you in. You don't have to be great at doing them. You just have to be aware, yeah, I can do this. Yeah, there is a practice, and I can do it. Just prove to yourself you can do it. Once you prove to yourself you can do it, then the fear of the death-free realm begins to dissipate. Because you're going to get hit, you will get hit with a continuity fear, a wow reaction there, for sure, for sure, for sure. Because you just say, oh my gosh, this is so wonderful, I can't believe it. You know, what happened to death? What happened to death? Well, it's not here. It's never been here. Instead of saying, wait a minute, you need to say, wow, that's all. So the real key to going to the death-free realm, to ascension, to rapture, is to just say, wow, instead of wait a minute. Okay. Take refuge in wow. Really take refuge in wow. You say, okay, I accept this, but I know it's a big wow, and I know I have to work on it. So, okay, I'm fine. I'll work on it. That's it. That's your ticket. Whereas you say, no, whoa, 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 wait a minute, wait a minute, whoa, 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 wait a minute. That's a problem. You'll back away from it. So you got to go from whoa to wow, from whoa to wow, from whoa to wow. And that's what we've been working on here. Some Christians believe that they got the death that was needed. Said, yeah, the only problem, the problem of guilt was solved through Jesus' death. That this was like the death of perfection. And that we proved that, so that this, Jesus' willingness to sacrifice himself for our sins, so to speak, meaning our deaths have not gotten rid of guilt. The death of these bodies we've been having hasn't got rid of guilt. So he said, wow, we need somebody who's truly, perfectly the sacrificial lamb that takes away the sins of the world, meaning our lack of taking away guilt. And so they thought that Jesus' perfection and perfect submission would take away the guilt. Only Jesus resurrected and said, hey, guess what? Can't kill spirit, and there is no guilt. So Christians are still struggling with this, and some are just are keep thinking, no. Jesus, if we just believe, you see, now the problem becomes one of belief, that we just don't believe, and everybody has to believe. So there again, this is the sort of the Christian thing, is we just have to get everybody to believe that Jesus' death took away guilt. And once we get everyone to believe that, it'll be true. You see, again. This is delusion. There is no guilt. There is no guilt to take away. So Jesus tells us, don't make illusions true, try to make illusions true and then get rid of them. This is the problem. He's speaking to the whole world, and certainly to Christians who have had this problem. They tried to make his death real, death of spirit real, by insisting that Jesus appear in a body, as a body, then kill the body. Tried to make the death of spirit real. You see? And believe in it. But more so, that's making illusions real and then trying to get rid of them. But we can be a little more clear than this. If I can push it out there, I don't know if I can. Okay, so Jesus, they say, well, he has a perfect life. In other words, he had the capability to be perfectly happy here. And yet, he too agreed to death. Okay, so we feel that's the most terrible thing ever. So we gave up the most precious thing. We gave up the ability to be perfectly happy in this world. But actually, there was only one problem that he had to die to this happiness, saying, yes, I am guilty too. And by my accepting death for my sin of being perfectly happy here, having the capacity to be perfectly happy here, that will finally atone for getting rid of the perfect happiness that we have with God and killing that, you see. So it's really, they said, well, arrogance sent Jesus here to die for our sins, to finally solve the guilt problem. But actually, arrogance didn't send Jesus here. That's how we interpret it. God sent Jesus here, the true God, to show us that you can't kill spirit. Therefore, you can't change the will of God. Therefore, there is no guilt. Obviously, if we didn't change the will of God, how can we have guilt about changing it? It's impossible. So obviously we're closing in on this situation, very much so. Obviously the answer's within me. It's just that I'm a little bit hesitant to, you know, put it out in super clear terms, because that, again, people feel that they're being attacked. So that's why there's still this little, tiny little bit of lack of clarity, you might say. Very insubstantial. It's very clear that arrogance interpreted Jesus coming here to suit its purposes, and repentance interpreted Jesus coming here to, you know, truly tell us the truth, and that there is no guilt. So there's no need to atone for guilt. Therefore, there's no need for death. How did Jesus resurrect? Because he just asserted that there is no need for death. So the body doesn't have to die. Death of the body isn't needed. So the body again rose from the dead. Rose from death. And so the arrogant said, uh-oh, I think we have a problem here. What are we going to do with this? And so he's been trying to make all sorts of crazy beliefs around this, you know, trying to figure out, what the heck do I do with this? And most Christians just accept the crucifixion and leave it at that. Our priests always used to say, you know, everyone, all Christians, they say, you know, they love the crucifixion, and that's great. He said, but very few pay any attention to the resurrection. So today we're going to focus on the resurrection. Everybody's kind of like, okay, and sprinkle the water and do a little ritual and, you know, all this kind of stuff. And then just right back to the crucifixion again. Yeah, Jesus died for your sins thing again. So arrogance is trying to sort of deal with that. Says, well, yeah, we'll pay lip service to it, but let's not really focus on that too much. Let's focus on he died for our sins. Meaning our deaths aren't sufficient enough. I mean, they basically say that God demands our death to atone for some sin that we did against God. So we have to die. That's why we have to die. But our deaths are not sufficient to bring about that. So basically we're just going to die perpetually. And so then we said, God said, wow, but I feel sorry for you. So, and also to save the world. Well, that's another point. He loved the world so much he sent his son to die here. Meaning, if we realize, hey, wait a minute, we don't need this world. We don't need death. We don't need this world. You know, we don't need it. We'll go for the death-free realm. So arrogance is so worried about that. It says, no. You've got to keep this. We work so hard to imagine this world of death, of constant death, this sacrificial universe of constant sacrifice. You can't let go of that. So what happens if they start thinking that they don't need it, you know? So then the arrogance said, I got to make some sort of situation where they remain fixated on it. And said, no, don't worry. So it's along those lines. And we'll see how this gets taken. I know it's like shocking to people, you know, but so I don't want to make it too clear. But I'm just hinting at it, right? That I know what the answer is, most certainly, or very likely. Okay, I very likely have it clear, okay, in my mind. It's just that speaking it to the world, you know, you have to be gentle about it. It's the resurrection. Well, that's the real teaching. You see, we realize that there's no such thing as guilt. We say, oh, we don't need this world. What do we need a sacrificial universe for? To atone for guilt? That's completely insane. There's no need for it. I don't even like it at all. And then without that sacrificial universe, there'd be nothing to sustain arrogance at all. We just look directly, wait a minute, there's no guilt. That means I didn't change God, so arrogance has no basis in reality at all. Poof, that's the end of arrogance. So arrogance frantically has to keep the sacrificial universe going. And what he did was, arrogance said, no, I sent Jesus down here to remind you that I love death. I love death so much, I sent my only son down here to die for you, to show you how much I love death. You can't set down death. That's I live by that. And then, of course, Jesus' resurrection said, guess what, folks? That was just the play of arrogance, the demanding my death. But now, this is the play. My resurrection is now the play of the true God saying, you don't need, I don't, God's not demanding death. God doesn't need death. God doesn't need any atonement for guilt. We never change God, reality at all. There's no guilt to atone for. There's no guilt to atone for. So why do we need all this death to atone? It's totally not needed at all. So, those of you who feel that, you know what? This is true, and a death-free realm is what I want, but I got this continuity fear. Well, just imagine, as we've been doing here, we can sit for hours discussing this, right, and looking at it. And the practicing, you can practice. I practiced this morning 5 hours or so. I am not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Right now, I accept God's final judgment upon me. I accept God's final judgment upon me right now. I am not a body, I am free. There is no will but God's, and I accept God's judgment upon me. You see, I was practicing this for 5 hours this morning. He said, you can practice and practice and practice. And it's just clearing out the confusion, and the doors open. I experienced these doors opening and sliding open. There's this huge vista of pitch darkness, absolute abyss, which I said, great. And I saw there's some entities, and they were totally pitch dark. That's how arrogance sees reality, as a complete abyss. And I realized that, and I said, wonderful. Doesn't bother me hardly at all. I was a little nervous. I said, thank God I'm finally seeing the perfect darkness. I am that perfect darkness. From the standpoint of arrogance, reality, God, is an absolute pitch black abyss, okay? So that's how we're used to symbolizing it. So when you see this symbol of this app, it's perfect darkness. When you see the perfect darkness, rejoice and say, wow, I can abide in that. I choose abidance in this perfect darkness using the symbols we're used to, okay? Ultimately, we won't symbolize that way anymore, okay? But to start out with, that's how we symbolize it. So I was seeing this. I said, oh, great. That's wonderful. I wasn't like panicking at all. I was saying, fantastic. Here we go. Now, I am having some trouble saying all this stuff because when I'm talking with, when I'm pushing the envelope, my throat, I have problems. I can hardly talk, and it starts trying to cough on me. So certainly this information is pushing the envelope and what we can tolerate. But what I'm saying is in the death-free realm, we can have teachers there. We can have teaching there. Absolutely we can. We won't be left just to our own devices, like thrown there, abandoned there, and say, okay, you're on your, you know, that's not very nice. We have a wow problem. We have a big wow problem. We might be able to tolerate a little area, okay, of it as safe. The rest of it might seem like pitch darkness to us, something like that. We might seem like to fade into twilight, and then darkness, you know, like that. It's like, wow, okay, I like where I am, but I'm not really ready to go further. And eventually we have to, you know, accept and recognize that this is just a simple way of arrogance symbolizing truth. It's complete pitch darkness, because arrogance, that's what it is. God, to arrogance, God's been destroyed. Reality's been destroyed. It doesn't exist anymore. So it's just an abyss. And arrogance thinks it's just a symbolic abyss. It doesn't really exist at all. So it might be that you feel comfortable where you are, but you don't really feel comfortable going anywhere else. And you have to, you know, eventually work this through, because in your mind, you think it's an abyss. So for me to be able to embrace the abyss, get close to embracing this idea of an abyss, the darkness that is the true light, the absolute perfect unchangeableness of reality, which arrogance sees as perfect darkness, you know, total darkness, that means I'm getting closer to being able to function in the death-free realm instead of just, you know, being pinned down in one location, I would think. Which, you know, is very useful to be able to do that, because you can go from place to place and help teach multiple areas. You know, the ability to go to multiple areas in the death-free realm, it is very, very useful and helpful to the plan of salvation, God's plan of salvation. Because most that go to that death-free realm initially, they just want to stay where they are, where they're at. They don't want to move around at all. It's too frightening. It's too awesome. It's too wowish for them. Because, you know, they say, wait, there's no death here, but maybe over there might be, you know, I'm not sure. If they realize there's no death anywhere, you know, it's like, wow, what happened to death? I mean, is this, what, how do we get rid of guilt, you know? I mean, so the ability to go to very many, many different locations, freely travel around there is super helpful, super helpful. And that's what apostles do. Keep in mind, when Jesus gave his teachings out, he gave it through apostles, and apostles did all the traveling. They traveled all over the place, right? Traveled all over the place. Look at Paul, what he did. So they just went to all different countries, all different places, spreading the good word, setting up churches there, and people then in their community gradually began to acclimatize themselves to this new teaching, you know, this fifth dimensional, death-free realm teaching. There is no guilt. We don't need death. We don't need it. See, Jesus said, you don't make death real. You don't make it so that we feel we really do need death, but, and then make death successful. See, that doesn't work. You don't make illusions true and then get rid of them that way. We don't say, oh, yeah, guilt is real, sure, but we just find the perfect atonement for it, the perfect death for it, and then that solves it. That doesn't work. Because to say that guilt is real means we have destroyed God. So how can curing guilt, so to speak, get us back to reality, our true home? It can't. The best it can do is have us stuck with this continual sacrificial dream. Really. So part of doing these videos is help reassure people, those who are going to the death-free realm, is that, yeah, somebody can teach there. You know, somebody is comfortable with this teaching and these ideas and practicing. And see, it's possible. It is possible. It's not that difficult. It's not that difficult. I don't have to stand in my head or lie on a bed of nails, you know, or hold my breath, you know, forever, or... Yeah, do all these yogic postures or anything. You just sit here and sit still, be quiet and sit still. That's the only thing you have to do. It's okay. You see, in the death-free realm, you may feel at first you don't really want to move around. I just want to sit here, because you're too kind of frightened. Say, whoa, 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 whoa. The wow is too intense. So I'm giving you permission to sit still and be quiet. This is very important. Apostolic authority to sit still and be quiet. You don't have to go anywhere. In fact, it's indicated that it's best not to try and go anywhere. And I shouldn't, you know, tempt anyone with, like, pictures or something. Look how beautiful it is there. Look how beautiful. Because they get all nervous. I want to go there, but I'm so frightened. You know, it's better just to do your spiritual practice. That's better. That's why beautiful graphics. It's sort of contraindicated from my experience. Saying like, wow, you know, you mean if I travel there, it'll be like that. It'll be this. Oh my gosh, I want to go, but, you know, maybe there's a place for it, for motivation. You know, we'll see. But the only way to really get the nerve to start moving about is right spiritual practice. And so you don't want to try to move about because that generates too much wow. You just want to focus on spiritual practice, and that will evaporate the wow. You have to sit quietly. It's okay to sit quietly. Be still. You don't need to say anything. In fact, don't say anything. Be quiet. Just listen. And maybe you get used to teachers coming and going, you know, to your enclave, and you say, hey, they're able to travel about, and it doesn't bother them. You know, so it's definitely possible. You know, so it gradually dawns. It's a gradual dawning, like, you know, and so it's work, it's discipline, it's a challenge, it's effort. Going to the death-free realm is a challenge. There's no question about it. It's a big challenge. But it sure is better than being in the third or fourth dimension. It sure is a lot better than that. And in the third and fourth dimensions, we'll say, you're a loser. What a loser. What idiots. You know, what are you doing? We have the answer here. You don't, you know, you're just avoiding responsibility and atoning for guilt. You know, you're just lazy. You'll pay the price later. You know, that's what they say because they're ignorant. They're arrogant. The ignorance of arrogance is very dark ignorance indeed. Arrogance just generates, you know, worse than ignorance. I mean, the basic ignorance is to ignore the fact that our only problem we have is that it's with arrogance. Ultimately, is that it's impossible. We can't. The goal of arrogance is impossible. There's no. We can't even pursue it one step. There's nothing we can change about God. So it's a non-starter from the very beginning. It's impossible. I don't like it. That's it. To ignore that fact then allows arrogance to claim that we're suffering from guilt, really. Arrogance introduces this idea of guilt, that we killed God, and our problem is we feel guilty about it. And that once we get over this guilt, then we'll feel okay about it. It's okay. But we say, yeah, that's what really God wanted anyway, so it's okay. Yeah. And they interpret Jesus as God sending Jesus in and saying, yeah, I love death. I want you to kill Jesus. That's exactly what I want. And if you kill Jesus, that will reassure me that you really, that your death, that you died also, you really meant it to atone for the guilt, you know, of killing God. So I'll give you a pass. I'll say, okay, yeah, you really meant your death. You really meant it. So that's why people say, well, I didn't really mean my death, because I don't really, you know, it didn't really work. Maybe I didn't really mean it. But if we get someone who really means it, you know, who truly, really says, yeah, I really want to die. I don't have any desire to live anymore whatsoever. And then if we just accept that perfect death, then God will look at that perfect death and say, oh, you accept that perfect death? And we say, yeah. And I say, oh, good. Okay, I'll accept your death too as atonement for guilt. This was really arrogance, is saying this. And you think, well, that solves the problem then. Solves the problem. It doesn't solve the problem at all, does it? And this is what, you know, fifth dimensional allies is recognizing. Wow, the stuff we tried before is very ingenious, very clever, but it has a stupid foundation. You see, and piling cleverness on a stupid foundation doesn't work. And the stupid foundation is that we mistook impossibility for guilt. We claim that, oh no, I don't have a trouble with impossibility, I just have a trouble with guilt. This is the stupid mistake we made. It was just completely arrogant. We just made it up. We made it up out of thin air, you know? And there's no truth to it whatsoever. So all this is now, you know, becoming clear, and I'm putting it out here, you know, it's not easy for sure. I don't want to anyone to feel that they're being attacked, you know. They think, wait a minute, I thought I had this problem, you know, fixed, and now they say I don't have it fixed and such like that. Maybe people will stop listening to the videos. That's possible. Or maybe people say, hey, wait a minute. Maybe there is a better way, a better answer. Maybe I did fundamentally misinterpret impossibility as guilt. And if that's true, wait a minute. Then maybe I misinterpreted Jesus' purpose. Wow, wait a minute. Say, this is interesting. And you'll get something like, maybe, you know what? This might be really great. And then the wow arises. You see, then you go, whoa. And I'm being attacked. Really, the spiritual path, you have to hear the truth. Okay, you have to. And this is going to generate a huge wow, because it's, wow, this is great. I've never needed death. And in fact, I've never died. I've never even been born. It's all been a dream. Hallelujah. It's such a big wow. You have to practice full stop on the wow and get very skillful at it. Otherwise, you're going to feel that the wow overwhelms you, and then you feel you're being attacked. And so the one, you feel the truth is attacking you. But this is the conundrum, the dilemma. Has to be resolved. I mean, the right spiritual practice is the only way. Have to resolve this. Now, we can pie in the sky at, you know, saying, well, I'll just do it directly and just, you know, right now. See, and, well, yeah, but you have a severe continuity problem. So it's really laziness saying that. Say, okay. I don't want to go through all this effort, so just teach me how to do it right now. Well, if you do it right now, there can't be any teaching, see? So what you're doing is just sidestepping all teaching whatsoever, and say, you know, which is really laziness. Plain and simple. That's what the Holy Spirit told me. I tried to sidestep it, and it didn't work. And the Holy Spirit said, what's wrong? And I said, you can't do it, or you can't understand what I'm saying. I said, well, yeah, I can understand. I just, well, then why are you avoiding it? You know, just like, Holy Spirit, maybe it's laziness, huh? You're lazy? And that really hit me. That hit home. I said, wow, it's right. Holy Spirit's right. It's laziness. I don't want to go do the work. I don't want to spend my life on this spiritual path continuity problem. I just want to enjoy life, you know. But how can I enjoy it when I'm trying to atone for sin, for guilt? I can't really enjoy it, you see? So I'm stuck. I can't really enjoy it, and I can't just immediately, you know, drop the all continuity concern and just immediately accept that none of this was ever needed. I never born, I've never died. It's all been a dream. And I just all at once completely get it just right now, forever. Couldn't do it. It's too much wow. So the only recourse I had was then, you know, working on the wow. That's it. And that's what I've been doing for the last 48 plus years. Actually, you know, 48 years, let's call it. Yeah. No, I'm sorry, 38 years. Last 38 years. intensely for the last 38 years. It's just working on the wow, walking in the wow. That's all I've done, walking in the wow. So we're going to be dwelling somewhere still, because we still are dreaming. So we're still going to believe we're some sort of form. Okay, so you can either be dwelling in the third dimension, fourth dimension, or the fifth, death-free realm. Okay, so you're going to spend your time there somehow. So why not spend it on walking together in the wow? See, why not? Because that frees you from the whole dream altogether. And we can't even talk about how happy you'll be then. So you might as well spend your time that way instead of just spinning your wheels getting nowhere. Is that frustration? You know, third and fourth dimensions just generate frustration. That's all they generate. Massive frustration. You can see how angry the militants are, right? There's a lot of militants. You see how angry they are, right? They're really angry. They're very frustrated. Just generates severe frustration, so... Walking together in the wow. If you spend your days that way, you know, you're going to pretty rapidly get to comfortable with the death-free realm, comfortable with it. And then you realize that, you know, the glory, the glorification of perfection, you get more and more used to it. And so it gets better and better and better and better and better until you finally don't even need the glorification of perfection. You're perfectly ready and comfortable for just perfection itself. Not even necessary for a glorification of perfection at all, eventually. And pretty soon, it doesn't take that long. So, this is a no-brainer, you know. You're going to be challenged one way or the other. Don't think the third dimension won't challenge you. It will. Don't think the fourth dimension won't challenge you. It will. It will severely challenge you. You can feel the challenge of fourth dimension right now. I mean, just keeping up with all the rules and regulations and technology and stuff is just like an impossible, almost. I mean, it's just, it's a hideous challenge. I mean, I just, you know, I gave up. I said, I'm not going to forget it. I'm not going there anyway. So what the heck do I need to know? In the death-free realm, it's very simple. It's a very simple situation. I mean, for me, I'm already accustomed to that fifth dimensional functioning. Get up, wake up in the morning, actually all night. I mean, I'd wake up on and off during the night, and eventually I'd wake up at maybe 5 in the morning, 4 or 5, and I just start spiritual practice. I lie in bed, maybe get up at noon. You know, I keep spiritual practice going intensely till like noon and get up, on weekends at least, and then start spiritual practice during the waking phase, and then do taping for a couple hours, you know, and then keep going spiritual. I'm pretty much, you know, round the clock already, spiritual practice round the clock right now. So that's getting ready for the fifth dimension. But you're not worrying about rules and regulations. Really, you know, you're just sitting still and quiet and very calm and peaceful and not really doing that much of anything. So what do you need rules and regulations for? There's no governance. There's no infrastructure necessary. I don't need any infrastructure for what? To sit where I'm at. Do I need some infrastructure for that? Not really. Do I need a bunch of production, a bunch of things? No. You know, get a fruit smoothie, and that's, you know, that's enough. Whatever. I don't know if you even eat in the fifth dimension. I don't even know. Maybe even not. You don't even need to. So basically, you're just kind of like enjoying the wow and the challenge. You enjoy the challenge of, wait a minute, you know, what happened to death? It's gone. What happened? So this is such a challenge. It intrigues you. It's just like, hey, this is really something. I really want to find out what's going on here. And that becomes your life. I mean, your interest. Yeah, you have this tremendous interest in figuring it out. Like, wait a minute. You know, what happened to the death universe? And what is this universe? And who am I, and why am I experiencing this, and why am I here? And you know, you want to clarify. I'd say that in the fifth dimension, clarification is like all important. It's like the air that you breathe. So certainly you can attend to this quite a bit, and you won't get bored. You might feel a little like, you won't feel that aimless. I mean, but you know, you're still like, you have some downtime maybe, but I don't know exactly how it works, but I'm quite sure that everyone can attend to these questions on a consistent basis. And it gets more and more interesting too, because you say, hey, you know, now I'm starting to see the truth. Holy cow, I just made this stupid, arrogant choice to insist that impossibility and my dislike of impossibility was really guilt. Wow. That's the error that I made. Wow. And it's never been true. It's never needed. Guilt's never been needed. Atonement for guilt has never been needed. And I mean, all the suffering I was doing, and that was just an attempt to atone for guilt, yeah. And those bodies, they weren't really me at all. Those are just proxies, you know. Spirit can't die or suffer, so I just imagine these proxies for spirit to carry out the guilt atonement. Wow, it's all just been a dream? Yeah. You know, this dawns on us, you know. It takes a while. It's a very, Just saying this, it's very intense, and in the mind, it's just like the mind just kind of wants to shut down a little bit from it. So gradually, in the fifth dimension, I would think you, the death-free realm, you expand. You've been traveling a little bit here, and just gradually, you ease. It's just a gradual thing of easement. Gradually, everybody goes at their own pace. Something like that. I don't know. I'm just conjecturing here. Now I'm starting to feel pretty hungry, but I don't want to make this too long, because. Just so you can get through this. And the wow is very intense right now, I'm experiencing. Now, we do need to go through this now, because I've really been given the heads up that we're in the period where all hell's going to break loose for sure. And nobody has immunity. I think the Donald Trump is helping the world by showing nobody has immunity now. Well, certainly, the third and fourth dimensionals, don't think that you have immunity just because you're a big shot in third dimensional big shot. Hardly. I mean, the fourth dimensionals got out the pitchforks and the torches, immediately. And the full-on village paranoia hyped up on moldy rye bread, It's like they all eat the moldy rye bread. They go into a state, a frenzied, hallucinatory state. They go grab the pitchforks, the picks, the pitchforks, and every other implement they can. And the torches, and start collecting wood for the bonfires and out of the phase. And they just go berserk. Says, let's burn this guy at the stake right now. Really? I mean, The out of the phase in the Middle Ages had nothing on the fourth dimensional's ferocity right now. I mean, if it weren't for some of the nice rules and regulations they have to follow, if they felt they had an excuse, they could be excused from it by some law, excused them from it, they would most definitely be burning people at the stake. Except they prefer more streamlined and efficient means of disposing of that which they can't tolerate. Very Orwellian. The fourth dimensionals talk all about tolerance, and yet they have extreme intolerance. Basically, what they call their extreme intolerance, they call that tolerance. How else can they live with themselves? How else can this belief system seem to be helpful if you aren't an extreme hypocrite? They're extremely hypocritical. The fourth dimensionals are extraordinarily hypocritical, which third dimensionals are able to see. They say, wait a minute. You did that, you said this, and you did this. And that's hypocritical. And of course, then they go back to their talking points. Well, you're a racist. You're a racist. You're a homophobe. You're a bigot. You're sexist, whatever other, the whole list of talking points. That's the only way they can handle their hypocrisy. They can't see it. They can't look at it, because that would delegitimize, the whole thing that they're doing. You say, wait a minute, you mean all this, everything we've done, and we're still totally hypocritical? How's that possible? It's not possible. Good governance has ironed that out. Right education and good governance has gotten rid of my problems, my hypocrisy. It can't exist, because I did the right things. It can't exist. So they're unable to admit that they're hypocrites. They cannot do it, because it's delegitimized everything they believe in. See, so they just then resort to zombie mode, talking point zombie mode. You're a racist, or rape. They love to call rape too. I'm being raped. Someone's being raped somewhere. What are you doing talking about this? You're sexist, you're racist. They just collapse into talking points. They can't look at what you're showing them. They cannot look at it. They cannot. They would delegitimize everything that they believe they've accomplished. Again, they feel that right governance, right education, right governance irons out all their problems, so they, therefore, can be perfectly happy. It solves the problem. You know, we're efficient at death. We're kind and compassionate during life, and therefore we're good people. And being good people means we don't have problems. So that means we can't be hypocritical or arrogant. It's impossible. So the third dimensionals and the fourth dimensionals don't get along at all, because the third dimensionals say, you know, they're going about a different way. You know, say, yeah, we're arrogant. Yeah, we're hypocritical. We're imperfect. But if we just submit to death the right way, that'll cure it. So there's a different systems, right? So the third dimensionals are willing to admit their problems, say, yeah, I'm not perfect. I mean, sure, I got rough edges, and I'm even bad. I'm guilty and wrong. I got all sorts of problems, etc. They own up to it, you know. They're honest. They're more honest about their failings. But they just say, well, you know, if I just accept Jesus' perfect death, which pleased God so much, that God is so pleased that Jesus was willing to give up everything to die, that therefore God's no longer angry at us. So once we die, we get to go to heaven, you see, and all our imperfections will vanish. That's what the third dimensionals believe. So the third and fourth dimensionals don't get along at all, because the hypocrisy of the fourth dimensionals and their insistence that they're perfect, you know, they don't have problems, just drives the third dimensionals up a wall, because they say, look, you said this, you did this. You're completely contradicting yourself. You know, what are you, I mean, you're full of hate. You know, they say they're so full of love, they're full of hate. They what they mean is they love to hate. They say, no, we're very loving beings. What do you mean? Well, we love hate? No, we love to hate. We love it. We love to hate. We love to execute people. We love to carry out holocaust. So we love it. What do you mean we hate? We're not haters. And the third dimensional is like scratching their head. Say, huh? You hate these people so much? You want to annihilate them and you're not haters? No. We love what we're doing. We're not haters. And so, that drives the third dimensional is just absolutely crazy. I mean, they're so upset, and I don't blame them. How can you blame them? I mean, it's just like cuckoo. Fourth dimensionals are absolutely cuckoo. But you have to understand where they're coming from. They've been following, for a long time, they've been following a path what they think is certain to work. And they cannot face the fact it hasn't worked at all. It just, they cannot do it. If they listen to this teaching, they'd be helped. They'd say, wait a minute, maybe there is a way. Maybe I can have a good laugh about this someday. So it's very important to have some humor and laugh about it, because they take themselves so seriously that they don't think they'll ever be able to laugh at it. You know. And to see that there is a way to laugh at it and say, wow, well, that was a long, strange trip for nothing, you know, but... Oh man, that must have been funny. I must have driven the third dimensionals up a wall with that, you know, and have a good laugh at that and say, wow, that was, you know, have a good laugh at yourself. Wow, I was just like incredibly hypocritical. Isn't that, I didn't see it. I couldn't see it. And man, now no wonder. The whole thing becomes funny. When I read the internet now, it just cracks me up. It just cracks me up. In fact, there's no better humor for me now than to read the comment sections of people, you know, the third and fourth dimensionals, you know, going at each other. It is just hilarious. They're just talking past each other completely. Third dimensionals say, just be honest. It's okay. Just admit your feelings. It's okay. You know, we're all sinners. It's okay. You know, Jesus has death satisfied God. God was so happy that Jesus was perfectly willing to die that God's no longer angry at us at our semi-perfect deaths. You know, we can still not really want to die, but God said, that's okay. It's okay. It's okay. No worries. You know, I'm no longer angry at you. You know, now you're perfect in my eyes. And so they're talking right past the fourth dimensionals. Be honest. Admit your mistakes. What's the matter with you? You know, Jesus forgives your mistakes, his death for you. And the fourth dimensionals are saying, no, I don't have any mistakes. What are you talking about? I've educated the mistakes out of me. I've governed the mistakes out of me. I don't have any more. What are you talking about? You're crazy. I don't see any mistakes. What are you talking about? So one of them says, deny all mistakes entirely. And the other says, no, and admit your mistakes, but that's okay. God's no longer angry at me at my imperfect death, because Jesus died a perfect death and satisfies God's desire for a perfect death. It shows that our will is where it needs to be, which is admitting that guilt is true. See? Because arrogance says, I'm not really sure you're admitting that guilt is true yet. You know, you haven't really died, been willing to truly die. And now we say, no, Jesus was willing to truly die. He admitted that guilt is true, absolutely. And his death then proved, and we love Jesus. So that means we love death just as much as you love death. Arrogance, no problem, you see, no problem, right? And arrogance says, sure, that'll work, you know. We'll call it good. These two camps are completely ships in the night, ships in the night, ships in the night. And it is just, I mean, it can be quite hilarious. Neither side gets through the other one at all. Neither side gets through to each other at all. It's gotten to the point now where it's just, you know, the fourth dimensionals, all they do is talking points. That's it. That's all they can say, just talking points. They just lapse into talking points. And the third dimensionals say, hey, all you're doing is talking points. And then that's pretty much it. It's just, let's say, hey, I think you're going to lapse into a talking point here. And of course, they do. And they say, well, here comes another talking point. And nothing happens. Nothing happens. There is nothing happening on those boards where people are coming to hey, you know, let's look at this in a different way together. There's nothing of, that's not happening at all. It used to be that you'd get sort of like faint efforts, like, well, I have to get along with you for a little while. Okay, I'll toss you a bone this way, maybe. Now it's completely abandoned the idea that we have to get along together somehow. And they're just like trying to chop each other. It's you don't exist, you're crazy. Basically, they're saying, you're completely insane. That's all there's to it. And, you know, there's nothing we can do for it. And we need to call out the insane from our society because they don't know how to follow rules. And the only way, and if they don't follow rules, we might lapse back into the imperfection that we have escaped. So we deserve not to lapse back into imperfection or lack of crazy beliefs. We deserve not to go back to those crazy problems we used to have. Therefore, you're trying to pull us back into that. Therefore, you deserve to die. And we'll send you to your death in a nice, efficient way. And that's a blessing for you, you know. I mean, that you're going to go to your death into this very neat, controlled, efficient way and be recycled into the earth. I mean, you're being blessed by that. And that'll help you with your problems, you know. It'll help you with your problems. And the third dimension will say, oh, really? Come and get it. You want some of that? Come and get it. We'll show you our way, you know, of death. This is just, I mean, if you don't laugh at it, you're going to be pulled into it. It's the lunacy, okay, of this whole, of arrogance altogether. This idea of the fourth dimensionals being terrified they might lapse back into having problems that they think they've escaped. Meanwhile, they're completely exposing all their problematical nature constantly, you know. And yet they say, no, I don't have it. You're just trying to get me to lapse back into that. deny. And fourth dimensionals are great deniers. They'll just deny, and liars. They'll just deny, lie, deny, and just never come clean. They will never come clean. It's like those PED users, the cheaters, you know. They just, you know, lie and refuse. A lot of those has a fourth dimensional mindset. Like, hey, I know how to, you know, get around all the restrictions. I know them so well, the rules and laws and regulations and bureaucracy. I know how to cheat it. And that's just being smart. They refuse to admit it, you know, just refuse until it really got really bad. But whereas the third dimensionals will say, yeah, no, I did that. They're taught to be honest, confess your sins right now. Don't go to bed, agree with your adversary right now, confess your sins right now, just say, get it out, and say, yeah, I did it. So it's a totally different thing. Your third dimensionals are caught and they say, yeah, I did it. Whereas fourth dimensional, they'll hire like every lawyer in the world to get them off and to bend words for them, you know, like Clinton, for instance, getting caught in the White House with Lewinsky, etc., the interns and all that. You just lie, no. And eventually fight over the definition, you know, fight over the definition. I did not have sex with that girl, you know, or something. We're fighting. It's a definition of words. It didn't really, doesn't constitute sex, you know. So, you know, I didn't do it. No, you're wrong. I'm right. I'm perfect. See, I'm still perfect. So, the fourth dimensionals think their spiritual leaders are perfect. I mean, sorry. They think they're politicians, who they think are their spiritual leaders. The spiritual leaders in the fourth dimension are politicians. They think their politicians are perfect. Perfect. Never done anything wrong. Everything they do is right. No, they're doing anything wrong. And when their leaders get caught, you know, bold-faced caught, they just lie. They're expected to lie. The fourth dimensionals expect them to lie. Say, what do you mean? I don't have a problem. You're the problem. You know, you saying I did something wrong is the problem. I'm perfect. I didn't do anything wrong. This is the problem, right? The third dimensional drives them up a wall, you know. And of course, idea is getting perfect, and then perfection deciding to die, then that pleases arrogance. It says, wow, wonderful, you see, you're proving that sin, that guilt is true. And so the way to get perfect with third dimensionals think that is admitting, oh, I'm imperfect. So I know my death is not going to be good enough, God, but if I'm honest with you, can you just accept the death of someone who was perfect here in my place? And then arrogance says, yeah, that sounds like a pretty good idea. You know? As long as we believe that guilt is true, it's all good. Whereas the fourth dimensionals are trying to say, no. When we die, it'll be the death of a perfect person, and that will then prove that guilt is true. So our way of dealing with it is insist we're perfect. We don't make mistakes. We don't contradict ourselves. No. Anyone who says we are is a racist. See, that's it. And this is what we have now. It is the funniest dog and pony show ever. I mean, it's the most ridiculous thing ever. It's high humor. I mean, it hardly gets more funnier than this in terms of humor, spiritual humor. You can see the irony in it. Just the complete farcical nature of what's going on. Total farcical nature of what's going on. And so different ways of trying to be perfect. I mean, the third dimensionals try to be morally perfect. They try to, you know, admit their mistakes and keep trying to be more and more perfect. So when they die, they'll say, you see, perfection decided to die. That means perfection believes in guilt. Now, what about those who just, you know, right, don't care about being perfect. Hell with it, I'll do whatever the heck I want, you know. Well, that's trying to mimic freedom, right? Perfection of freedom. And then they die too, and then they say, you see, freedom, the freedom of the perfection of freedom, that too died. So that proved guilt too. So all this kind of stuff is just an attempt to prove that guilt is real. That's it. Prove that guilt is real. And of course, making sacrificial atonements like the Jews were doing and a lot of ancient peoples was saying, yeah, God, I know I'm terrible, but I don't, you know, if you could just, I'm not ready to die yet, or my death hasn't come yet. Yeah, I know it will, don't worry, but and I want to, you know, show you that I'm trying to get better, okay? I'm trying to get more perfect, but I'm not there yet, so accept this sacrificial, instead of killing me right now, accept this animal sacrifice, just to let you know that I recognize that I'm not yet perfect, and so my death will not satisfy you yet. So let me sacrifice this beautiful lamb that looks perfect, you know, that no spots, no bad, to show you that I get it. We get it. That's kind of thing. Yeah, we get it, God. We're working on it. Got all these purity laws. We're trying to be perfect. We're really trying to be perfect. So when we die, this will assure you that we believe that guilt is real. Yeah. Worshipping you, arrogance, which is what most people refer to God. It's really they're really referencing arrogance. Son of God's arrogance. They say, yeah, we get it. Don't worry. We need some more laws. Okay, let's pass some more laws and make sure that we're ritually pure. You know, it's ritual purity is the big thing. The ancients are really thinking that would work. Ritual purity, every last thing we do, you know, make sure that it's ritually pure. So when our death comes, it'll be the death of a pure, perfect human being body, and that will then prove that guilt is true, right? Perfection can die. And this satisfies arrogance. You know, they're going to say, wonderful, wonderful. I like that. Then, of course, they think that by having that pure death, they get to go to heaven. I mean, they get to be happy forever after. That no more troubles. No more troubles. It's like, yeah, we proved guilt is true. And now we have and we've atoned for it. And now we have no more troubles. Guilt is true. And I was willing to die for that truth. And that, therefore, that frees me from any fear that I might have. This is just wishful thinking. It's completely wishful thinking. This is just the advice of arrogance. You know, wishful thinking. Just, don't worry about the little problems there. They'll come out in the wash. They don't come out in the wash. Not at all. Wash. You know, rinse. Dry. Be reborn. Come back. Well, your death wasn't quite good enough. You know, so. You weren't perfect enough. The only way to atone for the guilt is the death of perfection. When you're willing to give up perfection for death, then the guilt will disappear for you. That's what arrogance tells you. Yeah, he just hasn't quite disappeared. It hasn't disappeared from me yet? What, really? You mean that heaven wasn't quite as heavenly as you thought? Really? You mean it kind of wore off? Really? Oh, that's terrible. I'm sorry to hear that. But, well, you know what you got to do. You weren't quite perfect, so your death was not quite good enough. So you got to make sure you have a perfect death. I remember I came here, and at least the personality part of me was desperately trying to be perfect. I was absolutely desperate to be perfect. And I remember I did one thing wrong, and I started realizing I was making a few mistakes, and I was absolutely devastated by it. And I said, wow, my death is not going to be the death of a perfect person. That is not going to work. And I got frantic, frantic. I was really a perfectionist, and was told the truth. No matter what, I wanted to tell the truth. I wanted to be like a perfect person. And when I did something wrong, I just never forgot it. I mean, I remember in an Easter egg hunt they had at the high school, and I was like just a third grader or something. Everybody's looking at this huge field, and everyone's running around finding chocolate sticks and coins and stuff. And it was all these kids in there. There's little kids too. And this little kid was there. He must have been like a first grader or kindergarten or something. And we both saw this chocolate Easter bunny, and we both went for it, you know, and we kind of both got there at the same time, as far as I could remember. And maybe he got there first. I'm not sure, but it may have been that he got there first. But I also wanted it too, and I saw it. And I was only looking at the Easter bunny, you know. I didn't care what he was doing, right? As a kid, you don't care what someone else is doing or whatever. I want to get that. So I grabbed it, and I pulled it away from him. And I got the Easter bunny, got to eat the Easter bunny. But then afterwards, I realized, wait, what did I do? That's not fair. That wasn't fair. He got there first, you know. I mean, what might makes right or something? And I had this terrible feeling of guilt then, just crippled with guilt. And I've never forgotten it. All the guilt that I've had in my life, I still have. I haven't gotten over any of it. Because I said, that means I'm not perfect. So when I die, that won't solve the problem. So I've led a life of hideous guilt, actually. Hideous guilt. Because everything I did wrong, little stuff, I mean, most stuff that I've done wrong is like nothing for most people. They say, what? You're beating yourself up over that? That's ridiculous. Anybody would have done that. You know, it's ridiculous. But for me, it's totally unforgivable. Always got to be honest about everything you do. You know, never make. So it's just the guilt piles up and piles up and piles up, and say, wow, my death isn't going to save me. What the heck can I do? What the heck can I do? And the guilt got so bad, and I called out to Jesus, help, Jesus! I this is killing me. The guilt is so painful. The guilt is horrible. It's just you sit there and you feel like you're the worst person that's ever lived, and you will always be, and there's no way to resolve it, and you're only going to get worse because you're going to make more mistakes, and you're just crippled by guilt, completely crippled by guilt. And then Jesus came, answered my, you know, help. Holy Spirit answered, and then Jesus answered, and I said, "Don't worry. There's a way out of this problem." But I didn't know what it would be. Didn't know what it would be. it's really something. So I still have the guilt. I haven't let go of it yet, but I'm you know, closing in on it. Perfect death doesn't work. Doesn't work. That's why people thought that Jesus would solve the guilt problem through his death, would solve their guilt problem, because he never did anything wrong. You see, and that's why they're so insistent that he lived a perfect life. I mean, he got angry at the money changers. Said, "No. That was all. Everything he did was, you know, perfect." And so then they think that his death. Death being a perfect person will then, you know, prove that there is a way to satisfy guilt, and that we believe only through satisfying guilt can we be saved. But Jesus says, no, that's not the way. The way is to realize there's no guilt in the first place, no such thing as guilt, because we didn't change God at all. We just had this feeling of impossibility, and we misinterpreted that through arrogance as guilt. That's the problem. So you don't have to atone for anything, actually. In dream figures, what happens to dream figures doesn't generate guilt. You cannot generate guilt to one another. And this is what Jesus, in A Course in Miracles, harps on constantly, is you've never done anything wrong. Whatever happens to anyone is their own choice. It's a dance of trying to atone for guilt, yeah. But nothing happens against anyone's will, actually. It is very difficult to see. So in that grabbing that Easter bunny away from the kid, that was the little kid and me acting out a script where I would win, he would lose. I would feel guilty, and he wouldn't feel guilty. And he'd push the guilt onto me, you see. And he felt that would be the way, because then hopefully I'd find a way to, you know, get rid of the guilt. And this is like that, victim-victimizer. It's guilt that is causing this dance. It's absolutely guilt that's causing this dance. So nothing really happening at all to us at all. This is just a dream, a cartoon that we're having, the Spirit's having, of this universe, sacrificial universe. How do we, you know, please the guilt? We say, yeah, we have the guilt, but how can guilt, you know, forgive us? Say, okay, you don't need to feel guilty anymore. Yeah, you were wrong, but you don't need to feel guilty about it. Or, yeah, God deserved to die. You know, God deserved to die, and that's okay. He accepted his death happily. That's again with Jesus saying, "Oh yeah, God, you went to his death happily. Oh yeah, I'm happy he died." Say, "Oh okay, we weren't guilty. God wanted to die, so we're okay." No more guilt. Doesn't work. God did not die. God did not die. God knows nothing of death. God's will was not changed. God knows nothing of another will. There is no other will. There's only one will. God is the only will there is. So, if those who are going to fifth dimension, you can see how this can be unraveled, right? You're just seeing it's possible to unravel it. And you don't have to unravel it the right way, right off. There's a lot of unraveling. You look at it this way, this way, this way, this way. And you're just unraveling it all, and you realize, wow, it's not nearly as sticky as it used to be. It's not nearly as tangled as it used to be. And I'm not nearly as entangled as I used to be. Well, there might be a few more little knots here, but it's not nearly as untangled as it used to be. I'm very good at getting knots out of stuff. No matter how terrible the knot is, I've always been able to unravel a knot like in rope, in string and yarn, whatever. I'll just keep working at it. And I said, I'm going to get this knot undone for sure. I had one recently. It was so bad. I said, you know what? Let me just cut the, it was on the end of a rope. I said, let me just cut the rope off and throw it away. I said, no. I'm going to get this knot for sure. I was in a hurry too. I was like, ah, using my teeth, you know, and just trying to pull the knot, and just, well, I finally got it. There has to be a way, right? With a knot, there has to be a way to get it. Don't just cut it off and say, what the heck? I'll just die and that should, hopefully I'll take care of it. It doesn't work that way. Again, we can never solve it that way. You never say, yeah, yeah, God died, you know, and but you need to get over your guilt about killing God. So you need to learn how to die happily too. You know, say it's not so bad dying. So you can say, yeah, I really wanted to die. That's fine. Gotta get rid, you know, get rid of the guilt somehow of killing God. No, that's not the way, because you're still stuck with them that God doesn't exist anymore. Reality doesn't exist anymore. And that we're something completely different than as God created us. And then, you know, we have to figure out how to, you know, exist in the kingdom of time, which is the fourth dimension. Those are working on that, you know, both third and fourth. That's also part of, you know, how do we, once we get over guilt, then what do we do? Well, we got to, you know, live with death and all this stuff. We're so used to it. Maybe we can do something about it. You know? Anyway, unraveling all of this. You see, we can unravel it, get the knots out. And this is what those who go to the death-free realm need to be assured that they can work on this. They can work on it. They can make progress. Say, what about, let me try this one over here. Let me pull on this. Let me pull on this one. And let me ease up on this. And if it gets too difficult, let me just relax for a little while. It's okay. And then get back to it. And there's a little frustration, but you have to manage that too. Just say, okay, let me drop that. If that's not going, helping out, let me drop it. It's like a knot. If you get too upset, you're just like, you'll think, maybe if I pull on this really hard, it'll pop open, you know, and you start pulling really hard. What happens? It tightens the whole knot up. So you got to avoid that frustration. You say, no, let me just full stop in the wow here. So for me, doing these videos is proving to me that I can be helpful in the death-free realm. Absolutely. I'm learning how to be a teacher there. Now, I don't know how I could be a teacher in this world right now. It just doesn't seem to add up at all. Because the third and fourth dimensionals are just becoming rabid. You know, once a dog becomes rabid, you know, it doesn't really calm down. Once a leopard becomes a man-eater, you know, it doesn't stop. The leopards, you know, there have been man-eaters, tigers and leopards in various places in the world. Like India was really bothered by them. I mean, what happened was, during the epidemics that they had, famines and epidemics, they would throw their dead bodies into the jungle. You know, they'd take them out of the village and throw them in a ravine. That's what they'd do. To get them out. They didn't want to bury them in their village because, I mean, like, if you had Spanish flu or something like that, you know. So they throw them in a ravine, the diseased bodies. And of course, famine, people would just die out in the woods and fall down and, you know, just wherever they were. So what happened was the leopards and tigers then began eating these bodies, human bodies. And once they did that, it was easy food for them, you see. They didn't have to go hunt at all. So they lost the will to hunt regular game. They really, and so they said, hey, eat humans are easy food. And so then they begin to stalk people, children and stuff out in the boondocks, and they leap from trees. You know, leopards are very vicious hunters. As far as they, you know, they don't forget how to hunt. They just think humans are easy, and easy food, and they get used to that meat, and that's their diet. Then becomes that way, and this is one of the things that happens. Other times they get wounded in some way, and they can't hunt normally, and they humans are easy to go after. So. Leopards are the most dangerous of all, for sure. Very much so. They're more dangerous than tigers. They're not quite as big as tigers, which means they are able to hide themselves much more effectively. Camouflage, they're experts at camouflage, experts at stealth, super quiet, super stealthy, super great at hiding. Super agile, way more agile than tigers, and faster and quicker. Okay, they have all these attributes better than tigers. The only thing that tigers are better at, you might say, is brute strength. Okay, brute strength. But leopards are way more dangerous and insidious. So the fourth, third dimensionals are like leopards. You know, they're coming like leopards now, especially the fourth dimensionals. They're very stealthy. I mean, if they don't like you, you know, basically their ways are to get you dependent on electronics and then hack you, and just ruin, you know, make you nothing through hacking. It's very stealthy and clever and camouflage, right? And they camouflage the attack. Nobody even knows what happened, right? That's their preferred means. The third dimensionals are more like tigers. The fourth dimensionals are more like leopards. Very vicious hunters. When they're out to get you. So the POTUS is of course a leopard, a fourth dimensional leopard, and in the marriage equality ruling by Supreme Court, he tweeted a tweet of a flag, a rainbow flag, and the picture of it was a perfect profile of a leopard. In a leopard, you know, hunting side profile of a leopard is unbelievable. I mean, it's just amazing. You couldn't arrange a flag any better to give a profile of a leopard with the eye, the ear, the muzzle, the neck, everything. It's just astonishing, absolutely astonishing. It's basically saying, hey, we're leopards. You know, this is the flag, and of course, that's one of the beasts of the end times is the leopard with wings. You know, talking about. You know, the modern age with wings, being able to fly very rapidly, rapid response. The fourth dimensionals are destructivity through the quality of leopards. They sneak up on you. You don't even know they're there until they hit you in the throat. They don't even know, you can't even see them coming. They're so stealthy and very cunning, super cunning, you know. In ambushing and all this kind of stuff. So they prefer hacking, cyber warfare, hacking, just, you know, destroying your life, making you very sleek, elegant, you know, solutions to what their attacks and stuff. You know, like a leopard. So the leopard is their flag that they are, you know, this that shows their colors. They're really leopards. And leopards are, you know. When they attack, they just attack, you know, all out attack. They're relentless. They like I've said, you listen to there were hunters who hunted these man-eaters, and they said there's nothing worse than a leopard. Jim Corbett was the best of them all, and he, you know, what they'd call villages would call him when there's man-eaters, and he would hunt them down, and he hunted many down. And he said the worst are the leopards, no question about it. He says, you don't know what your heart is like when you're face-to-face with a leopard. You know, when you're hunting down a man-eating leopard, he says, that is the most intense. So we're dealing with the most intense predatory, you know, mindset right now with these fourth dimensionals, with this particular president, actually, and with what the ideology life philosophy that it stands for. And in California, those who stood up for traditional marriage found out that LGBT, something like that, community, they call it a community, it's really more than that. it's a movement, it's an agenda, and they were viciously attacked and intimidated for funding the amendment of traditional marriage. Like lepers, they act like lepers, really, terrorizing the people and stalking them. You know, it was hideous what happened. And so they're really leopards, actually. The gay activists are like leopards. And this is a bigger mindset. They're like the brown shirts of the fourth dimensional. They're very intimidating. They're crushing people right and left. You know, if you don't agree, they try to crush you. But stealthily, you know, like their ways they do it. And the overall mindset of the fourth dimensional Nazis, what they really are, is like leopards, okay? They fly under the leopard flag. That's their totem animal. And it's a very nasty totem animal, to say the least. There's nothing nice about leopards. Nothing nice about leopards. And the third dimensionals are like eagles or tigers, you know, eagles. You know, the eagles are very, you know, ruthless at hunting their prey, right? And very bold, even though they're not big, they're very bold and come down from the air, you know, bombing. The third dimensionals love to bomb people, right? The third dimensionals won't hack you and shame you and cause your business to fail and on and on and on and on and on. They won't. The third dimensionals will bomb you. Like Vietnam War, for instance. What are the third dimensionals love? I just love those B-52s, you know, and just drop bombs nonstop, carpet bombing. They love bombing. That's the eagle. Their emblem is the eagle. It's the American emblem, the eagle. Love aerial warfare. They love aerial warfare, especially bombing. So that's why you have all these stealth, you know, bombers right now. That's still third dimensional, sort of a blend of third and fourth dimension. They're using technology, but still bomb, 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 bomb. But the fourth dimensional is their style warfare, cyber warfare. Cyber warfare. Crash the banks. Crash the banks. Yeah, wake up one morning, all the banks are crashed. Gee, how'd that happen? Maybe a bomb hit the bank, you know? Maybe all the banks are down? Maybe they bombed them all? No? Oh, what happened? We don't, you know, third dimension's like, what the heck happened there? So the fourth dimensionals are like leopards. They will crash systems. They'll crash the economy. They'll crash money. They'll crash banks. They do a lot of very nasty stuff, say the least. And the third dimensionals are more like eagles. Like eagles, they'll bomb you from the air. Never have enough bombs. They say, got a problem there, just bomb them. No problem. Problem solved. Well, that hasn't quite worked. It worked out exactly as it... Didn't work out very well in Vietnam. They just went into tunnels. Went underground. You know, you look at the landscape, there's nothing like, looks like the moon. You know, and then suddenly all the VC pop out of the tunnels they were in. So it's like, whoops, you know. Had to figure that one out. Anyway, crazy world, huh? Absolutely crazy. I mean, again, third dimensionals and fourth dimensionals are not nice folks. They're driven by fear. They're driven by desperate desire to make their plan of guilt work, you know. So these are not nice folks, okay? Let's stop pretending they are. They're not. Third dimensionals are not nice. You know, well, look what they've done throughout history. And the fourth dimensionals, we're just finding out about these folks. You know, whoa. They say they're so tolerant. I mean, they're completely Orwellian. Completely insane. They're total hypocrites. You know, they preach tolerance, and yet they're super intolerant. You know, so they're not nice folks at all either. And we'll find that out pretty soon, just how not nice they are. So don't think you can find a nice, cozy relationship with third dimensionals or fourth dimensionals. They are vicious. You have to accept their insanity, basically. You know, third is like, yeah, as soon as I die, I go to heaven. That's it. Done deal. And the fourth dimensionals, no, as soon as everyone realizes I'm a perfect person, and then I die, and then it's done deal. Everyone has to accept I'm a perfect person first. So me, no, we're perfect. We're perfect. We're not mean. We're not intolerant. We're not bigoted. We're not racist. We're not sexist. It's like the fourth dimensional women are the most sexist people ever been on the face of this earth, actually. They put everyone else to shame. They put the male chauvinist absolutely to shame with their sexism. And yet they, if you say they have no idea they're sexist, they say, what are you talking about? We're perfect. We're perfect. You can't get, you know, it doesn't even dawn upon them. Yet they're insisting that they're superior, inherently superior to men. Well, that's not sexist. What are you talking about? That's just our inherent perfection. So they can't tolerate. They're totally intolerant to pointing out that the empress has no clothes. The emperor has no clothes. Totally intolerant of it. Viciously intolerant of it. And they're ready to institute their new world order to make sure that everybody agrees that they're perfect. You know, they don't want any third dimensionals around saying, "Hey, you know, you just said this, and you just said you're inherently superior, and you're always right, and we're idiots and should be slaves." And it sounds like you're the one being sexist. You know, what? I mean, there's nothing that infuriates them more than that. You know, they got to make sure that nobody ever says that to them, because their whole hope and salvation from guilt is that they can learn to be perfect. And regulate, and everyone agrees that they're perfect through that. I follow the rules. Did I follow the rules? Yeah, you follow the rules. Oh, that means I'm perfect. Yeah, you're perfect, sure. Yeah, you got the right education. You followed the right governance. You voted for the right politicians. That means you're perfect. That you managed to become perfect. So that saves you from guilt. See, guilt is so terrible. It is so terrible that it will do anything to get free of it. It's hideous. I mean, you cannot just abide in guilt, which I tried that. I'm guilty. I just abide. I don't know how to get free of it. I don't know. I'll just have to get used to it. It's horrible. It's horrible. It drives us to do like lunatics. And it's also completely mistaken. It's made up. Guilt is made up, 100% made up. Just an arrogant invention of ours that has no basis in reality whatsoever. The idea that somehow we change God's will doesn't exist in reality. It's made up. And this is what Jesus tells us over and over and over and over and over and over. Gradually it sinks in, gradually it sinks in, gradually it sinks in. And, you know, I can go back and you know, I'm aware that it's sinking in, because it's just in various ways, you know, it's all simpler. I'm able to focus in on what's really important right away. Don't waste time spinning my wheels, and just all sorts of stuff. Means, oh yeah, it's sinking in. It's sinking in. So the dialogue right now in the world is basically, hey, you're lunatics. No, you're lunatics. No, you're lunatics. No, you're lunatics. You know. Our way of getting rid of guilt is what's right. Your way is crazy. No, our way is getting rid of guilt is right. Your way is crazy. And that's basically where it's at right now. That's where the world is at. And, you know, if you're fourth dimensional who are following the rules of fourth dimensionality, then you can do no wrong. You can do anything you want to. I mean, you can get up there and say anything you want. You can say, yeah, all third dimensionals are murderers and rapists. And everybody else, and don't say, oh. You know, shrug his shoulders and turns around and says, hey, wait a minute, you said we can't say anything like that. What are you doing? Say, no, no problem with what we said. No problem. And then all the media will cover and say, well, this is the context they're speaking in. You see, you got to understand the context. Once you understand the context, you realize there's nothing wrong with it whatsoever. And the third dimension will say, wait a minute, you didn't even ask what our context was. In fact, you misinterpreted and refused to hear our context. And now you're saying that context is important. So you get to have context, we don't. And I say, well, duh. Sure. Well, because we're perfect. What do you think? And you're not. We follow the rules and you don't. So you don't get to be perfect like we do because you follow the rules. You don't follow the rules. You didn't vote for our candidate, so you're not perfect like us. And it's like that. And then when even the context can't be explained, well, they say, well, this